What a great experience to hear those memories. I'm so glad that you were able to fill in the background a little bit from the Pasay period of Philippine Union College and Adventist University of the Philippines. There is a rich history there and a tremendous story that I'm afraid we may be losing. So I'm so pleased that you could remind us a little bit about that. And I remember Typhoon Jean and the terrible devastation that it wrought in the Philippines, and tremendous destruction and suffering that came out of there. There have been many typhoons in the Philippines and before and since, but that one lives on in the memory, I think, of people because of the terrible destruction. It was January 7th, 1947, when the SS Marine Lynx, a military troop carrier, dropped anchor. Actually, it tied up to a dock in Manila Bay. It had left San Francisco some three weeks before, a little more than 3 weeks before. Wintertime crossing, very stormy. Stopped for 3 days or so in Shanghai, and another couple of days in Hong Kong. Disembarking some of the 3,000 passengers that were crowded aboard that vessel. And then it went on after Manila down to Singapore, and then on to Rangoon, and then back to San Francisco again. But we got off in Manila. And it was with great interest that my parents, my father Carl Jones, my mother Lucille Jones, were with high hearts and a high sense of adventure. So shortly after the Second World War, made their way across Manila with broken hearts to see what had become of the Pearl of the Orient during those war years. The city terribly, terribly shattered and destroyed. All of the major buildings flattened, government buildings, this great big central post office, many of you know and remember, and much more. Most of that damage caused by the Allies, by American and other Allied troops. I will not dwell on the stories that came out of that experience, but as we made our way, stopping at Pasay and seeing the hospital and the union offices there, and then made our way out to Kalookan, and passed the Balintawak Memorial, testimony to the tremendous revolutionary spirit and devotion to independence of the Filipino people. And on out to Maysa and our college campus. The campus had suffered during the Second World War, and even by the time we arrived there, there was a lot of repair to be done. I'll just say very quickly, a lot of broken windows in the buildings. Jackson Severance Hall, of course, all the glass broken out, and the buildings, the ancillary buildings for the music department, for the chemistry department, chemistry and physics, for the sciences, a lot of work to do. I remember helping my father trying to sweep up and clean up all the broken glass and shattered doors and windows and so forth. But we were able to figure out in time for the next term what was needed in the way of chemical laboratory equipment for the laboratory courses, and Bunsen burners and beakers and test tubes and all of that, and getting that order placed and getting those things in hand as quickly as possible. We discovered on that campus not only shattered buildings, which was a challenge. The gymnasium needed a lot of attention. I'll say another word about that in a few minutes. But we also discovered a people whom we, all of us, my father, my mother, my younger brother and I, we all fell in love with very quickly. Not a paternalistic, patronizing love, but with a tremendous amount of respect. We discovered particularly a people who had endured great suffering and great hardship with equally great courage. We were so impressed with the stories that came out of the experience of those people and during the wartime years. And we discovered a people who were tremendously resilient. Young people who were hungry for learning, for knowledge, who were devoted through all of those years of hardship and warfare, devoted to Jesus, to the Advent message. And it was just a natural fit for the time that my parents were there, that they came to see the Filipino people for what they really are, tremendously courageous, tremendously resilient, tremendously devoted to their faith and to Jesus. And it was a mutual inspiration all around. Yes, there were a number of American missionaries right after the war for a period of Reconstruction time, but there was very little tension. There was a tremendous sense of shared vision, shared purpose. Everyone was working hard together to build up that campus, restore it, and make it all that it could be, and get the classes going with as much normality as possible. It was fun seeing these faces come up on the screen before me, because it brought back so many memories. Memories of people who were much younger when I was much younger, but nonetheless, memories of these people and their families, whose names still ring on with hallowed memory among Seventh-day Adventist people over those years and the years since. I think this is perhaps the moment, really, Dr. and Mrs. Rosalito and Cora, to thank you for pulling those images together, and the officers of this local chapter for organizing this occasion. It's extremely meaningful and important at this 100-year anniversary that we do this. Of course, naturally, my perspective from those years really is that of a child, and I will not burden you unduly with that. But just a few quick little snapshots, and then I'll try to shift gears a little bit. My playmates were Filipinos, and that was good. I treasure and value that very much, still to this day. When we got out of school, we would then play together and explore the campus. It was a big campus. When I went back years later, it didn't seem so big after all. But during that time, there was plenty to do. Trees to climb, mudfish to catch in the rice paddy. Yes, there was rice growing on the campus, some of you will remember. A lot of other things to do. We tried not to get into too much trouble. Sometimes we got into a little. Most of those playtime experiences after school, which I enjoyed sharing with my Filipino friends, most of the time my pet monkey was on this shoulder the whole time. His name was Buster, and he and I were good friends also. It was an interesting experience. Sometimes my pet parrot on this shoulder, but never both at the same time. That was a bad idea. Yes, a lot to do and a lot to learn. We were told, we kids, that we understood very quickly that the campus out in Baisa, while it was a sacred kind of enclave in and of itself, around it, there were difficulties posed partly by the U.S. military surplus depot that was along two sides of the campus, who will remember. That was a source of trouble and problems a lot of times. We were told, everyone, Filipino kids and three or four American kids, we were told, you have the run of the campus, but never go outside. Do not go outside the gate. Well, you know where this story is going already. We did occasionally slip outside the gate. There were attractions, the little sorry stores outside the gate, where we could get we could buy hollow drinks, but mostly we would buy the makings, the materials for making kites, the tissue paper and the long spools of string. Because we spent a lot of time flying kites and fighting kites with each other, and we got pretty good at that. And whenever we wound up destroying our kites, we had to go back and get more materials, and we would slip out sometimes through those little shops to get those things. Of course, we didn't really have any serious money to spend, but I do remember Friday afternoon was my opportunity to earn just a little bit. In preparation for Sabbath, one of my assignments was that I must polish all of the family's shoes in the family, in preparation for Sabbath. And for each pair of shoes my father would give me every Friday afternoon, I would line them up and he would count them, you know. And for each pair of shoes my father would give me 10 centavos. That's 5 centavos for each shoe. If I saved that money very carefully, I could get some more material for making kites, you know, or whatever, and then outside. However, I must say I owe some debts to that community outside. They were very different from us. Most of them were not Seventh-day Adventists. They were Christians. They were Roman Catholics, of course, as you would expect. I learned some things from those Catholic friends. First thing I learned was that I was not Catholic and they are not Adventist. We're different from each other. But I also learned something about how religion worked in their lives. I learned something about the intense devotion, the powerfulness of their religious experience. I learned how the calendar worked for them. Christmas, of course, was a very important time of the year for them. For us here in the West, Christmas is kind of the climax of the year. But really, it's important in the Philippines. But really, the most important moment in the Filipino calendar was Easter, Holy Week and Easter, as you know. And we learned how during Holy Week everything would come to a complete stop, you know. And from the little capillas you would hear the people reading the Passion narrative in Tagalog over the loudspeakers around the clock. Families would volunteer to do this. We learn about devotion from Flagellantes. Many Protestants have misinterpreted what that is, but it was really, I now understand, a devotion to Jesus and a desire to share in his sufferings. From Protestant eyes, that often looked like a kind of works righteousness, but I understand it differently now. I learned something about festival, Flores de Mayo. I learned something about how ritual works in people's lives with great power. And while I always was a devoted Adventist, no question about that, I came to learn some lessons, even as I was at that gate that you saw the picture, the entrance, I'm looking out through the gate and observing the lives of those people. I learned something about how religion works in the lives of other people. And it influenced my life. My own studies for all of my life have been studies into how religion has power, how ritual functions and operates in the lives of other people. And so there is, well, I've always remained an ordained Seventh-day Adventist pastor and teacher of Adventism, of our doctrines. I've always, in some sense, been that little boy looking out through the wrought iron gate, looking at other people and seeing how religion operates for them. I thank those people in the barrio for helping me understand that. During the time when the Pope of that time, when it was very sick, in fact it was a sickness that took his life eventually, the torchlight parades, the novenas, the chants, the times of festival, seeing how cooperatively the people work together to harvest the rice, and how they, in the village at that time, would pound it into pinipig, in the sense of dance, and how to dance tinikling. Yes, I can do that. I don't do it as well now as I used to, but I can still do it. A sense of communal life that we all share, even somewhat across the religious boundaries, that was important. Sabbaths, of course, were a special time on that campus. There was a genuine sense of really sacred time when you have a community knit close together like that. My memories include very much that bell that hung in the tower of Jackson Severance Hall. During the daytime, it would mark the hours of the classes and the meals. And it was a good sound. But we did not want to hear it at night. There were many times during the night when the night watchman rang that bell. Midnight, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. And it meant there was some kind of trouble, difficulty of some kind. We were always afraid that fires would get started, maybe by accident or whatever, or something else. And there were many times when everybody, all the men, missionaries, Americans, teachers, Filipinos, students, teachers, faculty, all would quickly gather there to try to deal with whatever was the problem that was causing that bell to ring in the middle of the night. That bell has since been replaced, and the second one, the new one, also rang for many years on the campus there at Baisa. And you know where it is now, don't you? Huh? Yeah? It was moved out to Silan when the campus moved. That bell, the second one, that had about the same sound as the first one, was moved out to Silan. As the years went by, in my own experience, I came to appreciate several other things there. One was that library. It was a modest library, but it was one of the larger ones that we had on our campuses in the Far East. And I spent a lot of time in that library just reading voraciously. I was so anxious to learn everything. The other that I came to appreciate was the classes. The college classes. And there were times after school I would, to the great disappointment of my pet monkey, I would not take him with me. I would go to the college classes and sit in the back row or in Jackson Severance Hall, sitting on that terrazzo floor, concrete floor, outside the door where the professor could not see me, and listen to the teachers. And I learned a lot from the professors, Filipino professors, and some American professors as well. I'll mention very quickly just a couple other little things. The gymnasium floor was so badly torn up and beat up, their military vehicles had been stored in it during the occupation. We at first thought on Saturday night what to do. Sometimes they would show movies that they got from the PX, Army Surplus. Sometimes they said, well, let's try to have roller skating, and everyone roller skated. But that didn't work very well, partly because many people were not accustomed to skating, but partly because it was so badly torn up you couldn't skate. They finally came up with the idea of saying, oh, I know what we'll do. We will have marching. Yeah? And there were a couple of people on the campus who really knew how to organize these marches in very intricate ways. Circles wind up and wind back out again and crossing each other and so forth. You could do that for an hour and a half with and never repeating the same formation, you know? And one of those was my father. He had had a bit of experience with that. And so marching became the thing to do on Saturday night. You never knew who your partner was going to be, but it always changed in a few minutes anyway. That was an interesting thing. There was another kind of marching. Right after the war, there was a strong feeling that we really needed to help our young people understand that American, or I should say rather Adventist military people participated in saving life rather than taking it. And so one of the first things that was done there in 1947 was establish on that campus a medical cadet corps. And somehow my father wound up being the major, the number one officer of that. And we have videos of them out in front of Jackson Severance Hall, you know, lined up by platoons and squadrons, you know, and practicing their formations and so forth. That was not fun, it was hot. But sometimes they would have formal parades on campus. Sometimes on Saturday nights, just marching. Either way, they needed music. And so a live band was organized on campus. A band, a brass band, in which I participated. I played the trumpet. My father played the big tuba, you know, the big sousaphone. And the instruments were all old and rusty and beat up U.S. Army surplus. They were ugly, and they sounded ugly. So as well. But we did the best we could. I remember one hot, sweaty night we were practicing those different marches, and there was one in which, you know, at the end of a score of music, it says, go back and repeat, D-S, da-sing, a-fine, to the end, huh? Yeah? And then there'd be a different ending for the ending, and that says fine, F-I-N-E. So I remember one night we were working on, I don't know, one of those Sousa marches, and we completely murdered it. It was awful. And I remember that our kind director, when we came to the end, he pulled out his handkerchief and he wiped his forehead and he said, well, it says here on the music that that was fine. But he said, I think there's room for more improvement. And we practiced it some more. The years went quickly. I remember so clearly at one of the farewell functions for us on campus, standing up before a microphone like this and promising, actually a bit cheerfully, that I would come back. It would mean to be imitating Douglas MacArthur in his return. My education, if anyone would be willing to follow, to come with me to the Philippines, we would come back as two rather than one. And I'm happy to say that Pat committed her life alongside mine in that regard. After college, after seminary, we were pastoring the Adventist Church in Napa, here in Northern California. We were very happy there. It was a very nice place, good congregation. We filled out, after a year or so, less than a year, we said, okay, let's fill out our mission forms. So the general conference, we asked them to send us, fill out all this forms, paperwork. The last question on the paperwork was, if you had your choice, where would you prefer to work? You have three options, three choices, A, B, C. So as we finished that paperwork, it was time to fill that in, we said, okay, the first one, A, Republic of the Philippines. The second one, we put Republic of the Philippines. The third one, Republic of the Philippines. So the church sent us to Hong Kong. So we had a little time to do there and a little more schooling before we finally were able to to get out there to Ceylon, which is a beautiful new home. In 1928, a gentleman who had been working there in that field for some years, some of you know him in this book, Donald Warren, Idols of Opportunity. There's a copy of the book in the library at AUP. He wrote, during the time when the campus was still at Pasay, it was only 5 acres, it was small, it was tiny. And he said, and I'll just read a few sentences very quickly. He said, the past 15 years have been extremely, extremely fruitful for the work of Seventh-day Adventists in the Philippines, and the future offers prospects for still greater expansion. He said there are 300 students, so 1928, 300 students in Manila at the college, and 1,000 more in the grade schools and academies already at that time. The teaching force is steadily being enlarged. But he says the present location of less than 5 acres is too crowded, and this is not suitable for our campus. This is not the best place for our students. He said, and this is the last page of his book, he says, for several years it has been desired to transfer the school to a more rural location where there would be greater space and the students and teachers would enjoy the healthful environment of nature. And in his next sentence he says, the uplands of the Philippines are beautiful in the extreme. And many different locations have been found which would be ideal for the school. He says, as yet, funds have not been available to make this change possible. However, definite plans are now underway to carry out this project, and it is hoped that in another year or two, we will see these plans realized. Well, they were realized, but not to the uplands. Caloocan, Rizal is not uplands yet. But it nonetheless became the second home of the college, and a good home in many ways. He goes on to say to what extent the church in the Philippines, with good training of good young people, can eventually become a base for mission service in many other countries. And he mentions many other Asian countries where Filipinos were already going at that time as missionaries. You know and I know that that mission has been fulfilled over and over again by devoted Filipino people working all over the place around the world, Africa and many other countries. And so while his vision in 1928 was partly fulfilled, but perhaps not completely, we can say that now it has been. And if Elder Warren were able to see now the new location in Ceylon, he would say, yes, that was what we really need. So it's a real pleasure to share this afternoon and these memories with you. And by way of thanking the Filipino people from whom both Pat and I together have learned so much, for which we are so grateful. Thank you.